Nerd Academy podcast is released weekly at 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, available on our website at www.thenerdacademypodcast.com and wherever you listen to podcasts. You can find the Nerd Academy podcast on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. You can also help support the show by going to patreon.com/thenerdacademypodcast, where every donation allows us to bring you more exciting content every week.
Welcome back to Nerd Academy Movie Club. I am your host, Jared Buck with Subs. This is a show where your favorite nerds talk about movies. It's Dark Knight Month. We're talking about the Dark Knight. And it's been a long time since I've gotten a chance to watch this whole movie the whole way through, uninterrupted. And I like it more than I remember. I still like Batman Begins the most. But, yeah, I'm excited to talk about this one. And joining me, as always, is my scrumdiddly umptuous co-host, Devin Armel.
We're on number two, folks. We're already over the hump of this trilogy, and I don't want it to end. Joseph Gordon-Levitt Batman.
Hey, you know what? And you know what comes the next month is So Bad It's Good Month, our second year, and I'm still not 100% sure what all we're going to be covering for So Bad It's Good Month. But we'll figure it out. We're gonna have to because it's March 9th. So I only have a week or two left of going, what are we gonna talk about? But I don't have that luxury. Before we jump in to our review and discussion, we gotta give a quick word from our sponsors at Sunday's Bloody Mary. .com. Go to sundaysbloodymary.com/shop to get your hands on the most badass Bloody Mary accoutrement on the planet. You guys know I'm a big fan of the spicy Caesar mix. That's my jam. I have a jar in the fridge right now. I'm waiting to bust that open on some live streams. It's basically become my live streaming drink of choice. I got a mild mix for those of you who don't have the spicy Caesar up your alley. They got a vegan mix for those of you who want to avoid animal product. They got pickled garnishes like okra, dilly beans, and asparagus. I love some asparagus in my Bloody Marys, and rim salt shot glasses and other bar supplies of that nature. So go over to sundaysbloodymary.com/shop. Use code TNAP at checkout, TNAP. You get 10% off your order, and you help out your favorite nerds while you do it. Without any further ado, The Dark Knight. This movie is lauded as the greatest Batman movie. It's talked about as though it is the best superhero movie of all time. This movie has so much praise and so much hype behind it. A lot of it well-deserved. I do think that on the whole, the movie is slightly overrated. And I do think that even though The Dark Knight is kind of talked about as though it transcends the superhero genre, some of the biggest issues that superhero movies typically have are felt in this movie. And again, it's just Christopher Nolan's interpretation of these characters does wear on me after a while. And I'm very excited to talk about all of that. So, Devin, before we do that, you got some numbers for me.
Dark Knight, 2008.
Wait, I'm going to interrupt you real quick. Just got it. Product placement real quick. There you go.
It's okay. I respect it. 2008, 2 hours and 32 minutes long, directed by Christopher Nolan, stars Christian Bale, Michael Caine, Heath Ledger, Aaron Eckhart, Maggie Gyllenhaal, and Morgan Freeman. We have a 9.1 out of 10 on IMDb and a 94% on Rotten Tomatoes. The budget of this movie, it's $185 million. The box office comes in at just over $1 billion.
profitable.
Some would say.
Some would say. Some with counting abilities would say.
Includes an absolute grocery list of awards, including obviously Heath Ledger's Oscar-winning performance. So, yes.
Okay.
Oh, man, that's...
The movie is legendary for good reason. I think that, you know, I mean, even pre-Heath Ledger's passing, I remember, good God, I was in like third, fourth grade when this movie came out, and I remember seeing on the news that like theaters were questioning whether or not they wanted to show it because they were worried it was going to be too dark. It almost got saddled with an R rating. I remember hearing talk about that when I was a kid. Like, this movie had a lot of mystique going into it, and then unfortunately, Heath Ledger passed away. And I do think, and this is not to degrade and belittle the loss of Ledger and his performance and his impact on the movie, I think Heath Ledger's death is something that is inexorable to The Dark Knight. And I think it's one of those things that, like, we as media consumers, like, in America, I think there's a very strong desire to find a thing that cannot be duplicated because or continued because of a real world material loss of some sort, and decide that you cannot top it. You know, you see it in music all the time. Look at the way people talk about hip hop. Everyone always talks about you like Tupac and Biggie are the greatest and never be better than Tupac and Biggie. And we say that because Tupac and Biggie died while they were making their best work. They could not release a mediocre album after they had already done their multiple masterpieces, right? So we put them on a pedestal, and we memorialize them and we deify them as untouchable, because they died while they were at their zenith. And then you have people for years who grow stagnant, and it turns into, well, you can never top X because I've decided X is the ceiling. And I think we have a bad tendency of deciding things have a ceiling. And I think one of the reasons why I was thinking about this a lot last night when we were done with the audio commentary, when I was going to bed, I was like, I think part of my own aversion to The Dark Knight. Again, I fucking love it. I think it's an incredible movie. It is one of the best comic book movies ever made. I'm never going to say that's not the case. But I do think there is a level of perfect storm of like the time that it came out. You know, it was right before the superhero movie renaissance. It's kind of one of the progenitors of the superhero movie renaissance. There's, you know, again, the memorialization of Heath Ledger in this movie, you know, that I think makes it exist on a different level than other works, and maybe to an unfair extent. You know, I do think that a lot of times this movie becomes this movie gets treated as though it is beyond critique because of that. And, you know, look at the comic book body politic, as it were. You know, this movie comes out, and from that point on, it's like, well, it's never going to be better than The Dark Knight. There's this, like, preordained thing. The Batman comes out, and all we can do is keep comparing it to The Dark Knight. Right? Because we've decided that The Dark Knight is the movie to beat. Now, sure, you can say we can all generally agree this is one of the best of the bunch. Sure. But at what point do we, as fans and pop culturally, agree and decide that you can do better than The Dark Knight? Does that make sense?
It makes sense that, like, the possibility is there. I don't know, man.
I just feel like we decide a movie is the best that a certain story can do. Like, the amount of people who, it doesn't matter what you make or what comes out, you can never convince them that there's a better Star Wars movie than The Empire Strikes Back. And that's not to say that Empire isn't incredible. But there's a lot of people you will never convince Empire can be outdone. There are so many people you can never convince that Tupac and Biggie can be outdone. There's a lot of people you can't convince Hendrix can't be outdone. And the recurring theme is it's older, people who made it are dead, and it came out when I was young. You know, like, and you have that cocktail where, like, you have an entire swath of people who end up agreeing that the bar is here, but the bar can't be passed. And, like, it's a very toxic nostalgia thing that I think we societally, again, pop culturally, have kind of crept our way into. And I don't know. I think it's part of my accidental need to be contrarian. You know, and it's like, and I don't try to do that. But by the same token, when I hear people go, oh, you'll never be able to, oh, this is the best definitively, and you can't, there's a part of me that immediately is like, you can absolutely do better than this. There's no constraint here to say that you can't. So I guess that's why part of me enjoys the other Nolan movies more, is that I think that Batman Begins gets overshadowed by The Dark Knight. And I generally enjoy Batman Begins more than The Dark Knight. And I think Dark Knight Rises gets overhated. And that, you know, if Batman Begins and the Dark Knight are comic book epicness, but grounded and gritty, The Dark Knight Rises is comic book silliness, but grounded and gritty. And there's something really funny about combining those things to me. That you have, like, you know, because he's Batman logic all over Dark Knight Rises, but in a trilogy that has done everything in its power to not allow the same kind of comic booky allowances that can create a because he's Batman type. Mm-hmm. Restriction. But, you know, I will say there was a little bit more. There was more comic booky goodness in The Dark Knight than I had originally remembered there being. And that was fun revisiting it, because you get those moments of like, you know, Bruce kind of being quippy, and, you know, we talked about in the audio commentary last night. Whenever he goes into Hong Kong to go after Lao, and that, like, going towards the concept of the myth of Batman that we've been talking about since Begins, how terrifying that must be for the common criminal. That, like, oh, Batman was after this Lao guy, but he left Gotham, and then he inexplicably turned up in China to...
Batman's powerful, man.
Yeah. Yeah. And now, do people know the, you know, oh, well, Bruce Wayne went here and then he did this? Like, no, of course they don't. They just know that Lao was a kingpin who was in Gotham, and then Batman went to Hong Kong. How did he get there? They don't know, because they don't know that it's Bruce Wayne. So there was stuff like that. But yeah, I've been talking for a minute. Devin,
I sometimes wonder, like, what we kind of talked about, if Heath hadn't passed.
Yeah.
If he sat where Scarecrow sat in The Dark Knight Rises as the judge in that sort of like court full of criminals, that gives a that gives Jim Gordon and like a bunch of other cops the exile sentencing.
Yeah.
Like that was supposed to be Heath in the beginning.
Yeah.
I would pay so much money to see that scene.
Yeah, and I would love to see that. I'm sure that Joker had a bigger role in the story of Rises, whatever it was.
I like to think that he would have. I like to think that, like, I don't think that's even fan service at that point. I think that's like any company in the world, if you launch a product and like an aspect of that product is universally received incredibly well, you're going to like do some more R&D and try to even improve that product and bring it back. And like,
yeah,
I don't know.
Well, I think there's a great quote. It was either Steele Saunders or Ken Napsok who once said that fan service is whatever you think it is, you know, and fan service, like fan service has a negative connotation and it doesn't always have to, you know, fan service can just be like that. You know, I wish I had like a little ding sound effect on the soundboard. I don't for podcast listeners. I winked at the camera. Or for audio listeners, rather. You're all watching or listening to the podcast. But I think that there's a... Oh, man. I think that fan service gets a bad rap because we always associate it with like a gratuitous, like the story comes to a screeching halt and, you know, someone holds the thing up and does everything in their power to make everyone look at the thing. Because we know you like the thing, you fat, filthy fucking American. You know, we know you read the comics here. Yeah, no, not even Snyder. Like, there's a, again, fan service, to quote friend of the show, Alden Diaz, much like pornography, I can't define it, but I know it when I see it. And it's true. Like, I can't describe what fan service is to you, but if I'm watching a TV show or a movie that's based on whatever IP and there's a fan service-y thing, I could be like, that's fan service. But fan service to me is fan service to somebody else. And it also depends on whether or not you view that as like a nasty thing to put in your nerd story.
I don't think it's nasty. I do think sometimes like it almost distracts from the story.
It can.
Which like is never what I was saying. Like I thought this movie did at all. I think this movie like, I don't know if the villains started off as just like concepts of antagonists or if whenever they were writing the movie, they had a place where they knew they wanted Batman to start and a place they knew they wanted Batman to end.
Yeah.
And thought who could build him up, who could challenge him, and who could tear him down.
Yeah.
But not necessarily with like strength. Like
of course, yeah,
in any of those categories. And I don't know, I think when you use like when you look at Scarecrow in the beginning of the movie, he captures him, he builds him up. You look at Lau, he captures him overseas and brings him back. All these things that are building him up, and then like the things that challenge him, like the Joker, just like cold case, the Joker. I'm going to challenge everything that you freaking do. I want to see you break your one rule. I'm going to make fun of you and all of the schemers around you. And then the one that like beats him down, but not beats him down like physically, you know, it's like beats the Batman, at least like in the public eye.
Yeah.
Like once it's revealed what Harvey's done, then everyone's just like, oh my God, like Batman took the heat for all this shit. But in the meantime,
yeah,
Batman's not what it was just a week prior.
Yeah. And
I have so much love for that. I have so much love for that. I love the roller coaster of like the Batman in this movie. I love like him showing up in just like a bank vault in broad daylight, like, and then disappears again. Scans some shit. It's unmarked bills. All right, see you, Jim. And like, I love it. I love it.
I do too. I do too. And I think that one of my favorite things about Batman's characterization in this trilogy is the man who's willing to make the hard decision that no one else can. And, you know, it's Bruce's resolve that in the comics, you know, frequently Bruce's resolve ends up being an issue. Is that he crosses lines and he unintentionally hurts friends by being very gung-ho and doing what he's going to do at whatever cost he has to. And not, that doesn't always rub his allies the right way. Oops. And here we have him very much, you know, make that decision of, I will be the one who did these things. You'll hunt me. You'll hate me. And I think it is a uniquely Batman decision to make, to go, I will be your villain. And because the symbol of the Batman no longer is usable or necessary, I will disappear. And I think it's an interesting character decision. I think it adds to the mystique of Batman in this trilogy. I think it's also wild to think about the fact that Batman exists for 2 years, vanishes for 8, reappears for like a year, and then Bruce Wayne's dead. Dead, air quotes. Like Batman's tenure is very short in the Dark Knight trilogy. Mm-hmm. And it's something that didn't occur to me until last night, because I thought there was more of a time skip between Begins and Night. I really did. And then like Joker's like, you know, only a year ago, you and your group therapy sessions. And I was like, it's only been a year since Begins? Batman rises and falls in 2 years. Like, that's bonkers.
Yeah.
You know, and there's like a magic in a bottle that is this version of Batman. And it lends itself towards this idea that Bruce really does view. Overall, this trilogy makes it clear that Bruce views Batman as a temporary fix. And the philosophy of Batman is a little all over the place with this trilogy. And it's one of the things that I, again, whenever people go, oh, the Dark Knight, I kind of roll my eyes at, where it's like, yeah, well, in the first movie, he's very resolute in like, I am here to save this city. And then by the Dark Knight, he very selfishly is like, oh, I can be done now. I can be done now. And is like trying to like intervene in Harvey and Rachel's relationship, which is very like, that just doesn't feel like Bruce Wayne. And then by Rises, he redons the cape and cowl, despite the fact that he was trying to throw it away in Dark Knight. And while he's trying to throw it away, Rachel is doing the whole, oh, well, you can't quit Batman. Or like Rachel's talking about how Bruce needs Batman more than Gotham does. But Bruce really wants to get rid of Batman.
Yeah.
And then by Rises, he's proving her right that he just can't quit. And that like, and like Alfred says, like, you know, you're hell bent on having to die as Batman. Where it's very inconsistent to me, and perhaps, and again, we'll be watching Rises soon, and once I have the whole thing in front of me, having rewatched the trilogy in its entirety back to back to back, Maybe I'll land on this differently, but for now, it kind of waffles, you know, like even Zack Snyder and Batfleck are more internally consistent as a character, you know, and to isolate Christian Bale as the Batman who knows this is a temporary fix, that is the most consistent element, but there's still the, oh, you need Batman for you, which doesn't quite fit with the, it's kind of overly confusing and lends itself to my biggest criticism of this trilogy, which is that these are concepts more than they are characters. And going back to what I said earlier with, like, you know, even though this movie's supposed to transcend the superhero genre, like, I mean, people talk about superhero movies having third act problems. There's like shit just kind of happens by act three. Like, again, I don't want to get too cinema sinzy, and I don't want to like, oh, I'm actually logically, because that, you know, what asshole decided that art has to be perfectly logical? But when the point is gritty, grounded Batman, how the hell did the Joker fill that hospital with bombs? When did that happen? How did that happen? With whom did that happen?
Or two boats. Two ferries.
How did they know what boats? You know, it's stuff like that. Where, like, throughout the whole movie, like, there's a plausible deniability. Because, like, every move that Joker makes throughout the first, like, three quarters of the movie, you can couch in, he has the mob in his pocket, which means he has the dirty cops that are in the pocket of the mob to help him do shit. He takes Harvey and Rachel to abandoned warehouses. It makes sense that with, like, the amount of manpower Joker has at his disposal, that he could fill two abandoned warehouses with oil drums and bombs. You know, it makes sense that the Joker can just broadcast from whatever meat locker he's in and, like, kill people and hang them. There's all of the cops that he had to abduct to fill with his own people so that he could get into the parade so that he could shoot at Gordon and the mayor. Like, there is a reasonable, like, okay, I can see how he did that. I can see how he did that. There are so many bombs in that hospital. Like, you said it last night. Like, literally every window in the building is individually exploding. And it's like, he had to have planted a bomb in almost every fucking room in every hallway to get that effect. And again, it's a cool scene. It's iconic. Him and, like, the nurse drag with the goofy ass wig, you know, with, like, with the detonator doing, like, the t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t. It's an iconic moment, and I don't want to, like, deride it because it doesn't make any sense logically. You know, I don't give a fuck about that. But, like, like, it's cool, whatever. Like, but when the movie insists upon itself that it be taken so seriously and then has moments like that, I kind of roll my eyes a little bit. Like, you know, let yourself have fun. And it's little things like, I don't know, man, let the Joker's skin be bleached white.
I do wish that the gas was like Laffy gas.
You know, like, let's just have fun with comic book shit.
I love so much about, like, this version of the Joker. I just, you could have leaned into it just, like, a little bit more. Like, I get it. He's literally, like, there's so many suspected, like, this Joker's origins. Like, some, it's like he was in the military and, like, I don't know, he has some sort of, like, PTSD that, like, made him into, like, some brutal psychopath. You have, like, anyone of his given or his like provided backstories could be true. I don't think any of them are. And
no, none of them are.
Yeah, not at all. Just like, I don't know. I feel like I've always heard Heath Ledger's Joker been described as like an anarchist. And I agree. The agent of chaos thing.
I don't want to hawk it.
You don't have fingerprints. You don't have a name. You don't have dental. You don't have like any of these things. Like,
I have no problem buying that in the comics.
I don't have any problem buying that in the comics.
But when Batman's like, I've turned every cell phone in the city into a camera and a microphone, and Lucius, you know my identity. But because I have the suit on, I'm going to talk in this ridiculous fucking voice. Like, what? And again, the movie takes itself so seriously and then goes, comic booky bullshit, buy it. And then you're like, well, you're kind of embarrassed by your comic booky bullshit. Don't fall back on your comic booky bullshit unless you're going to be all comic booky bullshit. You know, I don't know. And again, maybe I'm watching the movie wrong. I am 1,000% okay with admitting that maybe I'm bad at watching this movie. But there's a part of me.
The inconsistencies are there.
Yeah. And, you know, like I said, like the third act stuff, you know, that's where like the Nolan writing starts to set in. Or like, you're like, I understand you have to have maybe a scene or maybe one line of dialogue where Joker like says why he targeted Harvey. But the fact that both Joker and Batman in less than 5 minutes of each other do the whole, you know,
you're incorruptible. You're the best of us. And that's why the Joker had to bring you down.
And like, you know, Joker's like, I brought him down to our level. You know, like they're both, like they both reiterate it because I don't know, maybe Nolan thinks the audience is that fucking dumb. Like, you know, to explain to us, Harvey Dent was the best of us and we had to drag him down and make and show the world who he really is.
It does have a significant impact on the ending of this movie and the time jump that comes after it.
It does. It does. But literally you have Joker and Batman giving almost identical monologues to Harvey about Harvey. Well, Joker gives one to Batman about Harvey. And then Batman basically repeats his own version of it to Harvey. Like, by this point in the movie, I think the audience understands that Harvey is who he is to the general public. And I think that, like Harvey's character is, in my opinion, one of the best elements of this movie. And I love how we see pre this, audio listeners, I'm gesturing wildly at my face, that Two-Face has always been a part of Harvey.
Yeah.
He's always had a proclivity for violence. Harvey is very vengeful as a person, you know, like Harvey does. No point in the movie I think is it a surprise that Harvey falls as hard as he does. He's very aggressive in the way that he goes after his enemies. You know, it's all there. And the second someone he cares about, and the second that like the rubber meets the road even a little bit, he's ready to blow David Dismalchian's fucking head off, I think is telling. you know, I think it shows that Harvey was never incorruptible and that he always had darkness inside of him and that he didn't need to be, you know, to quote Joker from another story, I don't think it's one bad day, or to take a Joker quote and talk about it. I don't think it's one bad day can make the rest of the world just like the Joker. I think one bad day can become permission. And I think Harvey in the Dark Knight is evidence of that. That his traumatic scarring, the loss of Rachel, the disrespect he felt leading up to all of that is permission for Two-Face. You know, and the Batman opens the door to that. And we talked about that as well, that like the Nolan trilogy, again, we'll be watching Rises soon, and maybe watching all three of these movies in relatively quick succession will illuminate this for me a little bit more. But it very much feels like this trilogy waffles on how necessary Batman is. Like, you kind of get to the point by the end of this movie that the Dark Knight is saying that Batman is a temporary fix that, if relied on for too long, ends catastrophically, as it does here. You know, it ends in tragedy. It ends in Harvey Dent's. It ends in Batman having to break his one rule and kill Harvey Dent. It results in the Joker's overall victory. I need to reset voice meter. Oh, okay. Did I sound like a robot at any point there?
Briefly.
Okay. Well, it went away. But, you know, there's... Son of a bitch.
You sound like Ben Affleck's Batman.
What was that?
I said you sound like Ben Affleck's Batman.
Tell me, do you bleed? You will. God, I love that movie. I love that trash-ass movie. Can you believe a year ago already Snyder Cut and nobody fucking cares anymore?
No one gives a shit. It was petitioned for 3 years.
Well, the crazies still give a shit. The crazies give a lot of a shit. But yeah,
they wanted to restore the entire
Snyderverse. Piss off. Anyway. But then Gotham needs Batman to come back. But then Gotham is happy to sacrifice the Batman. But then Joseph Gordon-Levitt's going to become Batman. You know, like, again, when we watch Rises, maybe we will arrive at a conclusion. But for now, the Dark Knight trilogy has, like, a really inconsistent, like, this is what it means. For, son of a bitch! You're having a bad day with voice meter.
Sorry.
My apologies.
We'll reel
apologies
it in.
To the crew.
I agree a lot with what you said. I thought about it a lot since we talked last night about like Gotham and its need for Batman. I think it's a fluid relationship. I am excited to watch Dark Knight Rises. I think it's an ongoing question. I think there's just like situations at Gotham and like the people in it put themselves in or have things inflicted upon them that, you know, law enforcement slash just like the law or governing offices can't particularly overcome in a timely manner where Gotham doesn't experience a lot of consequences.
Yeah.
And so like there just becomes a point in time whenever like, hey, if Batman were to show up right about now, like that would be so cool. That would really help us out. and likes to help us stop digging our own graves or like,
yeah,
just being whipped on. And I don't know. Bat Gotham, as we know after this movie, doesn't need Batman for 8 years.
And if you really want to go there, the reason it needs Batman again is a problem caused by Batman. Like a Bane type character rears its ugly head into Gotham because of a Batman type character.
I would say sort of. I do. I think that the League
Batman of... Batman adjacent problem, yes, is the next
the League
issue.
Of Shadows says in Batman Begins that they have tried coming for Gotham once before. We tried a new one, economics. And like, it doesn't work, whatever. Gotham needs to be burned to the ground and like rebuilt upon. And like, I don't know how they ever thought that was going to work, to be honest with you. But
it wouldn't. That kind of scorched earth bullshit is never the solution.
Yeah.
So
like it didn't work.
No.
Then like the plan was always to come back, but to have Bruce, someone from Gotham, someone with personal ties to Gotham, leading the charge for a sense of justice. Murder's not justice, especially not mass murder. So like Batman defeats them. Batman proves himself to be a powerful figure, a watchful protector of a guardian, not a particularly vengeful individual, but someone to be afraid of because he's so not much is known about him.
Mysterious and steadfast in his beliefs.
Definitely. And cites the challenge of the Joker. And he wins. But along the way, this little guy, Harvey Dent, who was like just bagging up left guys, left and right, in broad daylight with the justice system, doing it the rather like traditional way, becomes the hero that Gotham really needs at the time, especially with the help of one Batman, I must say, bringing Lao back. Like the grand, like Harvey Dent's, like, peak public idea or like concept rather, like public opinion of Harvey Dent, yeah, is based off of the arresting of like 530 however many criminals at once that only happened because Batman kidnapped someone.
Yeah. I mean, you're right.
Just, like, I just don't know. And had anyone else, law enforcement, Jim Gordon, anyone else stopped the League of Shadows in Batman Begins, I still think the Bane and freaking Talia al Ghul would be like, no, okay, no. The cockroach under our foot is absolutely Gotham. You know what we're going to do? We're going to just put a flamethrower against it for as long as we have to. And Batman's got to come back. I think Gotham needs Batman.
I think that...
in different capacities.
Again, any other version of Batman, Gotham needs Batman. Gotham needs the Bat family. It doesn't even have to necessarily be Batman. It needs someone to inspire hope and defend the city. But, like, again, the Dark Knight makes a case that Batman is a bigger problem than solution. Like, let's not forget the beginning, the best part of the movie.
Just breathe.
The best part of the movie, you know, what's the difference between you and me? Other wearing hockey pants. Best goddamn line. Oh, yeah, I forgot. I was going to make that my name originally, and I forgot. I was just going to say not wearing hockey pads. But like, I think of that for a hot second. You know, we talked about it briefly last night. Imagine that shit in the real world. Because let's be clear about one thing. You are not going to get well-adjusted people and people with like a good grasp on reality who want to be like extra Batman. You're going to, that was gross. You're going to get like militia douchebags. You're going to get like three percenters and Proud Boys and Oath Keepers who are putting on armor plating and bringing sawed off shotguns to drug deals that they heard about and getting themselves and others killed. You know, like that is a problem the Batman introduces. You introduce the issue that, you know, organized crime has to get craftier to fight back. You know, like, again, to kind of, this is semi-unrelated, but, you know, you talk about what you know. As our listeners know, and as I've talked to you a little bit, you know, I have my weird obsession and fascination with the online far right. And one of the things that is so difficult about nailing down some of those assholes is that when you kick an idiot off of Twitter, you know, even though that it's the right thing to do because they are spreading misinformation and hatred and they are inciting violence, you kick this person off of Twitter, they're going to keep doing what they're doing, and they're going to keep doing it to a smaller audience. But now the audience is more radical because you made them go into the shadows where we can no longer monitor them. And a similar thing is at play here. Yes, the Batman has scared Gotham's worst into secrecy. But now that they're in constant hiding, you're not going to be able to get your hands on them as easily. And then you have to rely on Batman even more because he can do the things that the GCPD can't. And every time Batman acts out of accordance with like what the GCPD is allowed to do, assuming you even have a cop who wants to go after a Salvatore Moroni or a Lau or whomever, they kind of start to catch wise. Like Moroni even says, he's like, you know, we all know your game. A fall like this isn't going to kill me. And like, yeah, Bruce drops Moroni and he breaks his ankles and it's all of that. But like, Moroni's not afraid of him anymore. He's not going to enjoy the ass whooping he's going to get. And we see Moroni walking around with a cane by the end of the movie. But like, you're not going to kill me. And since Batman, rightfully, and I'm not saying he's wrong for this, but because Batman is unwilling to escalate his tactics, he stagnates while the others just kind of get worse. And then you have the Joker who comes into the mix simply to disrupt order. And, you know, he does everything he does. And you have people who idolize Batman, people who hate Batman. You know, there's so many moving parts that Batman has made the situation more complicated than it would have been without him being involved. So the movie kind of like it arrives at a very open-ended but kind of confusing conversation about whether Gotham needs Batman by the end of this movie. And again, this is a story about a Bruce Wayne who recognizes hanging up Batman is necessary. And seeing Bruce have a happy ending is not a thing we normally get in Batman stories, and we'll talk about it in the next episode. But it's so much. I don't know. It's very rich and it's fertile ground for conversation. But I don't know. I do think this movie kind of ultimately advocates against Batman.
Batman takes some hits in this movie. Yeah. You know, criticism, the loss of Rachel, the loss of maybe I said this briefly last episode, but a part of me does think that like the things that happened with Rachel, the she's going to wait for me, the kiss that they share before like they separate at his penthouse, I just can't help but wonder. Like, it felt very quick last night when at the very end of the movie, Gordon's talking about, you know, how everything will be undone once it is revealed the monster Harvey became. It was so quick, so quick for Batman to just be like, I can do those things. Like, let him remain the symbol of hope that he was supposed to be. Pin me down as the bad guy. Peg me down as whatever. A part of me is just kind of like, ever since Rachel died, it almost felt like it fast-tracked.
That's interesting.
Like, Batman's wanting to, like, hang it up.
See, that's interesting. Because for me, I look at that scene, and Bruce's resolve to defeat the Joker is stronger than it ever was. And he beats him, and like Batman, you know, he does not, as a well-adjusted Batman, he is not fighting Joker for revenge.
No.
He is fighting Joker in the name of, I will defeat you because it is the right thing to do to save this city and for all the lives you have taken. You know, we don't see him kind of come unglued and start beating Joker to a pulp for Rachel, right? And Bruce, I think this whole movie recognizes how important Harvey is towards actually helping Gotham. And I think it's interesting because I think that without Rachel, Bruce has every reason to want to continue his work as Batman and not give it up.
You would think.
And I think that it goes to, again, where Rachel's conclusion that Bruce needs Batman more than Gotham, again, just it doesn't gel with the character they're presenting.
Yeah,
it's because he very quickly goes, Harvey Dent's more important to this city than Batman. Let Batman be the bastard. And
I almost again, wonder if that was like a petty comment from Rachel. I guess it was
a letter. But again, it goes to the fact that Nolan does not know what the fuck he wants Rachel Dawes to be. You know, it's Nolan and Goyer and Jonathan Nolan don't know what the hell to do with Rachel.
She's just wrong.
Kind of, yeah.
Bruce at doesn't even get step. To read the letter and, like, on his own gives up being the Batman. Granted, it was for, like, a just, like, reason and cause. But, like, I don't think that Bruce needs necessarily the Batman. I think that there is a void in Bruce. And I think that his two leading suspicions of things that would fill that void is the Batman and or Rachel.
Yeah. And I think if he wanted to tell a story about a Batman who needs to learn to quit Batman, he's still active for those 8 years and is using Batman as a coping mechanism, not unlike what we see with Ben Affleck. But we get Bruce, who's been retired and comes back for one last ride. But I don't know. I think that, again, Rachel is the biggest crutch of this movie. Or is the biggest weakness this movie has. And it is not Maggie Gyllenhaal's fault. You know, it's just, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. And I don't think anyone who has written these first two movies has the damnedest clue as to what they want to do with Rachel Dawes as a character.
She needed to have an I don't date co-workers policy, and she needed to stick to it. And
yeah. You know, and again, and it's not that I'm blaming. I don't want it to come across as like, you know, like the, oh, it's Rachel's fault. Like, no, like it's the Nolan's fault because they can't write her to save their life and give her a consistent ethos that isn't just like being Bruce's unrequited love who keeps teasing Bruce.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, I don't know. It comes across as sophomore-ish in the way that she's written, insofar as that she's like, everything's like, I'll wait for you. They'll never let us be together. I'm going to marry Harvey. Like, Nolan can't write women to save his life, and he really can't write this one.
She's not even actively waiting for him. She is seeing someone else.
She's about to marry someone else.
They've been together long enough that, like, Harvey brings up the question of marriage. Like, you're publicly with him. You're, like, tag-teaming the DA's office trying to, like, do your daylight justice. I just, like...
Daylight justice.
Like, Batman's sitting there talking to Alfred after she dies already.
Yeah.
And he's just like, she was going to wait for me, Alfred. She already wasn't, Bruce.
Like, yeah. But she said she was. Like, right before, he's like, they'll never let us be together. Like, a part of me is convinced Bruce dreamt that conversation.
Yeah.
Like, it's just so inconsistent with the rest of the movie. And again, it's not Maggie Gyllenhaal's fault. It's the fact that the Nolans can't write her. It's a big weakness these movies have. And again, I don't think they're beyond reproach. Again, I think these movies are really, really lauded as something that you just can't critique. And
I think we're doing a pretty good job so far.
They're great, but they have very glaring problems. And again, you know, it's just I wish these movies, this one in particular, was just a little bit more, you know, let's have fun with it. You know, like, Two-Face is horrific. And there's a part of me that's like, yeah, I think you can do realistic Two-Face that isn't this hard to look at. You know, like, I think the Arkham games find a happy middle ground between, like, the whole distended eyeball and you can see the cheekbones and shit. Like, clean them up a little bit. Make it a little bit more, you know, you know, let Joker's skin and hair just look like that. You know, like, what, like, again, for a movie that wants so badly to be a gritty, serious look at Batman, like, why didn't GCPD wipe off his fucking makeup?
This movie has a complicated relationship with top paid cast and makeup. So, you know, at least they're consistently inconsistent.
You know what? And we at the Nerd Academy appreciate consistency.
We do appreciate that.
Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade coming out. Fuck you. That's why. But yeah, no. I'll go first for final thoughts and letter grade. I think this is an incredible movie. I think that it belongs in the pantheon of some of the greatest comic book movies of all time. I do think it's slightly overrated, and it's not my favorite entry in this franchise. I enjoy Batman Begins as a Batman origin story so much, and I love The Dark Knight Rises as a character study of the hope and power of Batman and his indomitable spirit. And, you know, it's not bad. It's just not my favorite Batman movie. And I think it has its flaws. I think it soars. I think everything that's iconic about this movie speaks for itself. You know, you have the incredible practical effects, you know, the bus flip, You know, the fight choreography actually isn't terrible in this movie, which thank God. There's no like unintelligible, you know, just fight. Because that's what it looks like all throughout Begins. You know, yeah, I love this movie. I think it's incredible. And rest in peace to Heath Ledger. He turned in an incredible performance as the Joker. I think this is exactly what a post 9/11 Joker looks like. And yeah, I give it a B.
Solid rating. Definitely see a lot more of your opinions than whenever we just like we're walking into Batman Begins. And there's like, you know, we just said it's inconsistency. There's definitely a lot of like character inconsistencies, some like I'd say tinier, like I don't know, man. The third act of this movie, like when SWAT is first entering like the Joker's holdup building, there's a lot of like back-to-back shots where it seems like people are just extras or just kind of waiting around and kind of just like very slowly walking through it, but the gun's like not up, but it's not down either. It's like right here. And it's just like, wait a minute. Is that guy's hands duct taped together? Wait, Batman's here. Wait, that guy's hands aren't duct taped together. It's just like, that's what I think that they're thinking.
And again, also with the amount of times that like Batman just be like, Gordon, the doctors are the clowns and the clowns are the doctors. But he doesn't.
He doesn't.
Because
just called but again, him. 2 minutes
and in any other movie, in any other movie, I'm like, fine, that's kind of fucking stupid, whatever. But like, because it takes itself so goddamn seriously,
you gotta deliver.
You kind of hurt yourself with that.
You gotta deliver in those moments. This movie's so dark between like Joker and like the leaving of the hanging body of the guy in the Batman costume. Between the videos left over for him, between Harvey Dent's half of face.
Yes.
I like this movie's just like unreal. It's so dark. And a part of me loves that. A part of me loves that, like, I don't know. I don't know how I feel. Like, when I think like grounded Batman, a part of me is just like, okay, I'm cool with like Joker being like, you know, mystery character, could be military, could be some veteran, could be whatever. But then there's another part of it that's just like, how great would it have been if that bank teller dude, like, you know, bus starts driving, rope pulls clip of thing canister in his mouth, and like, you know, had the smoke come out, and then he just starts laughing uncontrollably after that. Part of me is just like, that feels in my heart like a missed opportunity.
Yeah.
And that kind of like makes me a little sad. I don't like that. I don't want to
like
be sad.
These movies are kind of embarrassed by what they're inspired by. I think that embarrassment like brings us to the version of Bane we get in Rises. And I love that character, but that character isn't fucking Bane. It's a completely new character. Christopher Nolan's Bane is just as much an original character as Rachel Dawes.
I just like, I don't think, like, being Christopher Nolan, I don't think you have to look at some of these characters and just be like, there's absolutely no way that this could exist ever in real life. We'll keep the name, we'll keep some of their iconic tendencies, Bane's face mask, Joker's scars slash face and green hair, and like, we'll just contort it and morph it to fit into this, like, average American day Gotham City.
But like, Bane's a fucking luchador. He wears a luchador mask. He doesn't have some kind of like Darth Vader wrist radar. Like, you know, like he doesn't.
Not even the mask then.
Oh my god!
All right,
just let comic book characters be comic book characters. You know, people are willing to accept really wild combinations of gritted of grounded and fantastical. Look at the MCU. The same like Captain America and the Winter Soldier takes place in the same universe as like fucking Thor Ragnarok. And nobody bats an eye. Nobody bats an eye at the Rainbow Bridge and the Norse gods and all of this, the crazy monsters and aliens and shit. And then you can still tell this grounded story about a guy who, like, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's possible to do both. I want my Batman stories to do both. I want a story that like takes Bruce seriously as a character, but also isn't afraid of comic book whimsy. And, you know, and again, dark and whimsical are not mutually exclusive to each other. Look at Batman Returns. Not a great example, but dark and whimsical can coexist. It just takes the right, you know, sensibilities to know how to balance them.
I totally agree. And I don't know. I've been thinking about it a lot since I've seen The Batman.
Yeah.
I need personally like a superstar villain for this next movie. I can't do the like deeply grounded in reality, almost like depowered, like physically versions of villains, but like higher mental, like twisted, sadistic, manipulative, like villains. Like, even if the villain's like tech based, like give us like an actual Mr. Freeze, or like give us like. Like, I need someone that's like from the comics, an opposing physical force, as well as make him clever and smart. Like, just like, I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm giving this movie an A-.
All right. Well, I mean, I hope you guys enjoyed this conversation. I know I've enjoyed having it.
I've enjoyed this conversation. Sorry for all of my yawning.
You're fine.
It is in the morning.
It is the morning. And I hear you on all of that. Devin, where can the lovely people find you, bud?
Guys, please follow me on Instagram at Devin J. Armel or on Twitter at Devin Armel 31.
Jared, I just love how you're like, please follow me. Every time it's so follow cute. Me.
If you want.
Do it. Devin's hot. Someone go comment on all of Devin's Instagram posts and call him a sexy little bitch.
Oh my goodness. My mom won't like that.
Oh, don't do that then.
Just played. Jared, where are you located on the webs?
You guys can call me a sexy little bitch on my socials at Dark Jedi 2552. And you can find the Nerd Academy podcast on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, and on our website, www.thenerdacademypodcast.com, where, if you're feeling generous, you can donate to our Patreon page.
Give me a dollar!
Speaking of our patrons, thank you to our $10 alumnus, the Waffle Wizard, Delta 9, your friendly neighborhood, Odo, Rang, Garland, Java, blah, 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 and guest on our The Batman review, Nick Johnson. If you guys are $10 patrons, you get at early access to this show. You also, as patrons, get access to the Versus series, Heroic History 101, and our, and you'll normally get links to join our live streams, for like Collins and stuff. So yeah, go to the student store link on our website. You can get some good old TNAP merch.
TeePublic.com.
So yeah, thank you all so very much for watching and listening. We'll see you guys next time for The Dark Knight Rises, and cut.